may be concealing days of blue. And as the hour we of hunger for is near, beneath our tread the earth shall tremble, we are here. Because the hour we of hunger for is near, beneath our tread the earth shall tremble, we are here.
So became the last against the midst of bed.
The son of Jewish partisan Don Felsen and the president of the Jewish Partisan Educational Foundation. I am honored to welcome you to our third annual Yom HaShoah V'HaGevurah program with the voices of young people from Seattle, Washington to Cape Town, South Africa who have been inspired by the legacy of the Jewish partisans. For those of you new to JPEF's work, we teach the history and life lessons of the approximately 30,000 Jews who fought as armed resistance fighters during World War II. Tens of thousands of educators worldwide use our innovative educational materials to empower millions of students every year. For the past 22 years, Holocaust organizations have relied on our extensive and free resources. On Yom HaShoah V'HaGevurah, we remember the millions of lives we lost during the Shoah. We also honor the many people who resisted the Nazis and their collaborators. Tonight, our keynote speaker, Emmy and Peabody Award-winning producer and director Paula S. Apsell, will share some of those courageous acts with us. We will also pay tribute to the remarkable resilience of the Jewish partisans, many of whom were teenagers who fought back in armed resistance against their oppressors. Like my father Don and my uncle Stan, often escaping from camps, ghettos, and killing fields, these partisan brigades were active in at least 10 European countries, from Greece and Italy to Poland and Belarus. In the Jewish tradition, we gather on the anniversary of a loved one's death to light a yahrzeit candle commemorating their passing. Between 1938 and 1945, 6 million Jews were systematically rounded up, starved, tortured, worked to death, shot, and murdered with gas. These were sons, daughters, mothers, fathers, brothers, sisters, aunts and uncles. Many of them were parents, grandparents, and great-grandparents of those of us here today. It is a tremendous honor to have 5 Jewish partisans and 5 of their grandchildren with us tonight. We light 6 candles in memory of the 6 million Jews and 6 million non-Jews who perished during the Holocaust, and a candle for Yom HaZikaron in memory of those who perished during the War of Independence and the fight for a Jewish homeland in Israel. Joining us tonight from the Markov Brigade in Poland is Jewish partisan Jerry Kajdanow with his wife, Holocaust survivor Ellen, and their granddaughter Sarah. From the Stalinskaya Brigade, Alan Small and his grandsons Scott and Andrew. From the Yegorov Brigade in Czechoslovakia, Jewish partisan Paul Strassman and the youngest Belsky brother, Aaron Bell, joined by his grandson, David Abrams, and great-grandson, Yehuda. Joining them are members of our third-generation partisan community, Joshua Kotler, grandson of Belsky partisans Leah and Abram Kotler, Olive Sholem, Jonathan Kushner, JPEF board member and grandson of Belsky partisan Ray Kushner, Olive Sholem, accompanied by his wife, Kim, and JPEF board member, son, and grandson of Holocaust survivors, and an IDF soldier, Hadar Wazotsky, together with his daughter, Tess. As we light the candles, we hold in our hearts those partisans in our community who we lost since last Yom HaShoah. We remember Sarah Bedzo, Judith Ginsburg, Adriana Trosik, and Faye Shulman. May their memories be a blessing. Cantorial soloist Daniel 14 of Temple Beth Sholem in Needham, Massachusetts, will sing the El Male Rachamim at the conclusion of candlelighting.
This is Aaron Belsky, the youngest of the Belsky family that was a part of a partisan that fought in the forests of Belarus. I am David Abrams, his grandson, sitting next to my son, Yehuda, representing three generations here today. And none of that would be possible without the courage and tenacity of those that fought to allow us to live, to thrive, to be a part of what's now today approximately 25,000 descendants. It is our duty as a third and fourth generation to continue telling the story. It is in the honor of the Belskys and all those that fought along them to light this candle tonight. Yehuda, can you hold our hand? And Poppy, we're all gonna light the candle together. Are you able to reach Poppy? Oh.
Wait, one sec. Okay.
Thank you, JPEF, and all those.
Okay.
My name is Jonathan Kushner. This is my wife, Kim. We're in our home in New York City, and we're lighting this candle in memory of my grandmother, Ray Kushner, who is a partisan.
I am Ellen Kader now, and I am a child survivor of the Holocaust.
I am Jerry Cade now. I survived the Shoah in the Narish forest of Belarus, where I served as a scout for the partisans of the Markov Brigade. Today, we are living in New Rochelle, New York.
I am Sarah Cade now, Ellen and Jerry's granddaughter. Together, we light this candle in honor of all of those who resisted during the Holocaust and have shared their legacies with us.
This is a tribute to the memory of my large family, which consisted not only of my father and grandfather and uncles, but also people they married and the children they begat in the year 1944-1945. I was lucky enough to save myself at the age of 15 by joining the Partisans. So this is a tribute which I pay in their memory.
My name is Joshua Kotler. I am the grandson of Belsky partisans Leah and Abraham Kotler. I am representing all six of their grandchildren as I light this candle in the memory of my grandparents and my grandfather's parents, Meyer and Zelda, his brother Shelma and sister Bluma, as well as my grandmother's parents, Ida and Lade. We light this candle in gratitude for the lessons that my grandparents shared with us about the importance of standing up against tyranny and injustice in the world.
Hi, my name is Hadar Wisotsky, and I'm a first-generation survivor.
Hi, my name is Tess Wisotsky, and I'm his daughter.
We light our candles by passing the light of memory and hope from one to another. We honor those whose lights were put out, whose dreams, hopes, and lives were snuffed out before they even lived.
We light a candle for the untold millions for whom there is no one to mourn, whose entire families were annihilated, and who lie in unmarked graves.
We light our candles for those who stood upright while others were bending to unmoral will, for the righteous among the nations who risked and even gave their lives to help their fellow human beings.
We light a candle for those who live even now under the yoke of oppression, in places where the threat of genocide is real and ever present.
We light a candle in memory of our great aunts, uncles, and grandparents of the Wisotsky, Fuchses, Anschels, and Lorenzi families. We are the embodiment of all your prayers. We are not the forgotten. We are your legacy.
My name is Andrew Small, and I'm one of Alan Small's grandsons. My grandfather fought as a Jewish partisan in the Stalinskaya Brigada. He cannot be with us tonight, but he sends his regards and asks that we light this candle in memory of his family and in honor of the bravery and courage of all Jewish partisans.
El male rachamim shochen bamerumim hametze menucha nechona tachat kanfei hashechina im kedoshim utehorim kezohar harakia mazhirim lenishmot yakirenu shealchu leolamam ba'al harachamim yastirem beseter kinafav leolamim ve'itzror bitzror hachaim et nishmatam Adonai hu nachalatam, ve'anuchu b'shalom al mishkavam, v'nomar amen.
Thank you to Cantor 14 for the beautiful chanting of El Male Rachamim. We are so fortunate to have these five survivors with us tonight. We see the same strength and tenacity of each of them after 75 years that they drew upon in the forests of Eastern Europe. That incredible determination has brought tonight's honoree, Jewish partisan Mira Shelub, into her centennial year. So tonight, it is my privilege, on behalf of JPEF's board of directors and staff, to present a special tribute to Mira on her 100th birthday. In 1942, at just 18 years old, Mira escaped from the Jetel ghetto. She joined a partisan group engaged in sabotage against the Nazis and their Polish collaborators by disrupting communications and transportation to the war front. There she met her husband, Nachum. When anti-Semitism among the non-Jewish fighters in their group became too present, they left and formed their own partisan brigade, fighting the enemy until liberation. Partners for life, they raised three children and have two grandchildren and three great-grandchildren. Since the beginning, Mira has been an integral part of JPEF, working with us to share her story, help us develop our lesson plans, and visit thousands of students throughout the Bay Area to share her empowering story. It is my honor to present JPEF's tribute to Mira Shelub.
Never say that it's too late. Never say that it's the last straw. Never say that you cannot see the light at the end of the tunnel. Because hopes, dreams can come true, can materialize. We young men and women, as partisans in the forest, for the courageous battle against the enemy, for a better tomorrow, for a better day, for a better future.
Mira has amazing people skills. And this is seen when we bring her to classrooms, when she'd be the keynote speaker at Yom HaShoah programs. Everyone loved to hear what she said because she had such great poise and such great ability to speak and connect with people. This is, I think, also incredibly illustrated when she was perhaps 15 or 16, she escaped the ghetto with her sister and joined a partisan group. And her parents were still in the ghetto in this work camp. So with her incredible people skills, she convinced the partisans to take this risky mission and go back into the ghetto and rescue her parents. And it was really attributed to her incredible people skills and to be able to engage and to get these strangers she just met, these partisans, these men, to help her save her parents' lives.
always was inspired by the story of my father and my mother as being heroic partisan fighters, is that these people said, we are not going to be victims, even though the circumstances were so victimizing. We will somehow not just fight back, not just survive, but someday thrive. That's the kind of woman my mother Mira has always been.
What my grandmother would always say is, you don't know what you're really capable of. You don't know what you can do until you have to do it. And so those words always resonated with me.
She would say, endure, soldier, one day you'll be a captain. And, you know, at first hearing that, I was like, what does that mean? Like, what is she talking about? And getting older and hearing it at different points, the meaning of it was more significant.
And Mira was one of the first survivors that I met. Mira is someone, when she shares her story, she shares it through her heart. And she has great passion. And she always was sure not only to tell about the dark times of the Holocaust, but that the love that she had with her husband, who she met in the forest. And they give our students hope. They give our students a way out of darkness. They inspire our students to make a change in the world around them and to take a stand against hate.
In 1984, she said to herself, when she was 62 years old, I am going to fulfill my ambition to complete a higher education curriculum and achieve my degree. Nonetheless, in 4 years, in a timely fashion, she graduated magna cum laude.
It's truly incredible to realize how exceptional she was, along with my grandfather, and it's an inspiration.
It's okay to stand up for yourself and oppose something, even if it doesn't rise to the level of what they went through. I love my grandma. I think she's continues to be an amazing person.
As an ex-partisan, I would like to conclude with a passage which I read that helped so much. The past is always a prelude to the present. The present forever a preparation for the future. The past can never be forgotten, but at some point it must be forgiven. If we are ever to build a world of peace upon the planet of love.
I would like to wish Mira a fabulous 100th birthday. Know that we are all, and I myself, and an ambassador for your story. I have so much love for you, Mira, your wisdom, your passion, and I will continue to share your stories in the classroom and with our future generations in decades to come.
Mira, I wanted to wish you a happy 100. I can't believe we met each other 20 years ago, and you will always be a friend of mine, a dear friend. I miss talking to you and you calling me Mitch. I need to see you soon, and so I can hear you say my name, which I really love. Happy 100th birthday, Mira.
What a truly fantastic life she has led. On behalf of JPEF, I am honored to present Mira Shelub with the Aishas Kyle Award, the Woman of Valor Award, on her 100th birthday. We look forward to delivering this to her in person. Thank you to her children and grandchildren, Irv, Mark, Elaine, Aaron, and Nathan, for making this tribute possible. On Jewish resistance during the Holocaust, Nobel laureate Elie Wiesel wrote, "The question is not why all the Jews did not fight, but how so many of them did. Tormented, beaten, starved, where did they find the strength, spiritual and physical, to resist?" Our keynote speaker has dedicated the past several years to bringing recognition to heroic acts of Jewish resistance during the Holocaust. Paula S. Apsell began her broadcasting career at WGBH Boston, fresh out of Brandeis University. She enjoyed a meteoric rise through the ranks, eventually finding herself at the helm of Nova, where she served as the senior executive producer and director of the WGBH science series for 33 years. There she oversaw the production of Nova documentaries and miniseries for television. Today, Nova is the most popular science series on American television. In 2018, Paula was awarded a Lifetime Achievement Award from the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences. In 2016, she produced and directed the documentary film Holocaust Escape Tunnel for Nova. Now the executive producer of the nonprofit Leading Edge Productions, she has worked closely with JPEF on her upcoming documentary film, Resistance, They Fought Back, scheduled to premiere in January 2023. It is my honor to introduce Emmy and Peabody Award winner, Paula S. Apsell.
When I tell people I'm making a feature documentary on Jewish resistance during the Holocaust, the response all too often is, what resistance? Professor Natalia Alexian of Touro College in New York says that every year when she asks her students what they know about the Holocaust, the answer is the same. The Jews went to their deaths like sheep to the slaughter. We've all heard of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, but as scholar Avi Noam Pot says, paradoxically, many people believe it was the only uprising. So how widespread was Jewish resistance? This past summer and fall, my effort to answer that question took my film crew and me to Poland, Lithuania, Latvia, Israel, and the US. I learned that contrary to what many believe and few people know, Jews waged at least 60 armed rebellions in ghettos and 25 in concentration and forced labor camps. As JPEF has shown, thousands of Jews fought valiantly with partisan units across Europe. But equally important, we learned that resistance came in many different forms. Much of it had nothing to do with guns and grenades. With weapons largely unavailable, Jews resisted nonetheless, setting up soup kitchens, illegal schools, and documenting German war crimes, maintaining cultural activities and spiritual observance. This unarmed resistance has come to be called Amidah, standing up against German edicts designed not only to kill Jews, but to dehumanize them. And millions of Jews were engaged. We're now editing our film, so let's take a look at a short reel.
You have a contradiction between what people thought and what actually happened.
People have this myth stuck in their heads that the Jews went to their deaths like sheep to the slaughter. But this is where the real story begins.
You can't say that the Jews were silent. That's absolute nonsense. The Jews were armed. They were ready to resist.
It's hard to excavate, but we are sure there are weapons still in these places.
The prisoners were able to collect a number of knives and very primitive grenades.
Escaping is a form of resistance.
You're not going to break my humanity.
There's no way you could put a value on that kind of resistance. That stays forever.
So this is the story that gives you power to live.
Jews did not go as sheep to the slaughter. They fought back.
In the few minutes remaining, I'd like to summarize a couple of the stories emblematic of the heroism of the Jewish people, who with few weapons and little help from the outside world stood against the Germans. Fast forward to 1944. The Germans are losing the war, but their zeal to kill Jews is unabated. In a campaign led by Eichmann himself, the Hungarians are the last group of European Jews being deported to Auschwitz. Then in the camp, four courageous Jews managed to escape two by two, arriving in Slovakia with enough information in their heads to compile multiple pages of detailed records of the killing machine they had left behind. These Auschwitz protocols, as they were called, when released to the outside world, finally led to action. Political pressure on Hungary halted most of the deportations, saving 180,000 Jews of Budapest. A few months later, there was an uprising in the camp among the Sonderkommando, prisoners forced to dispose of the bodies of Jews killed in the gas chambers. Though few survived, they succeeded in destroying Crematorium 4, and shortly after, the Germans closed down the camp. There are tens, hundreds, perhaps thousands of stories like this that remain untold. Historians have studied the Holocaust for more than 70 years, but the narrative that has reached the public remains incomplete, especially where Jewish resistance is concerned. Before any more time elapses, we owe it to history and to the memory of those who confronted this unimaginable evil to set the record straight. For more than a year, it has been my pleasure to collaborate with JPEF as the leader in educating young people about Jewish resistance during the Holocaust and in spreading the legacy of the Jewish partisans throughout the world. By sharing the lessons of the Jewish partisans with educators and students everywhere, JPEF is having a profound impact on empowering our next generation of upstanders. Let me introduce you to some of them now.
Everyone is entitled to knowing the story of the partisans because it changes you for the better. It redesigns the way you think about the Jews during the Holocaust as victims, because that intense campaign sparked in a lot of people that intense strength.
I want my students to learn about the partisans because it's a story that really gives a vivid sense of both survival and resistance.
And that when people say that Jews didn't fight back and didn't resist and that we went like sheep to the slaughter, that that's not true.
This curriculum allows me to let them actually get to meet some of the people who survived this, and not just as survivors, but also as resistors.
Until I was 13, 14, I didn't know that anybody fought back. And that's not only an important part of history, but an important fact of life. I just thought that everybody suffered. Like Paul Strassman, whom I did my project on, he deserves to be not only recognized, but his story deserves to be told for what he did.
It's a huge impact for people my age to learn about other people my age and to have these great examples of like people being so like powerful just as teenagers. It's really kind of like a guide to like how powerful we could be as adults in the future.
There's more to survival than just basic needs. We have to look at all the things that make us humans and We can't just let those things go.
Those stories are the stories that will inspire us. And these are the stories that hopefully in the younger generation will stay with us as stories of inspiration and resilience. And the Jewish Partisans Education Foundation is doing it so well.
To me, JPEF and the history that it preserves and that it helps to teach allows me to teach my students Jewish history that makes them feel good about themselves and inspires them and lets them know that one person can make a difference.
They're human beings who were able to do something so influential and so powerful when there aren't any more partisans and survivors to tell their story. We need those testimonials to keep the story going. And I think it's so powerful to hear from someone who lived through it.
It definitely teaches a lot about kind of the merits of taking on risk for what you believe in. And I think also ties in with the larger history of the Jewish people, and whether it's, you know, Hanukkah or Purim or the Holocaust, it's kind of the story of pushing through and maintaining community and tradition in face of oppression and not letting that make you compromise yourself or what you believe in.
Thank you, Paula, for your work showcasing Jewish resistance during the Holocaust and sharing a preview of what we can all see as a compelling film. We are grateful for your work and for collaborating with you. Watching the students and educators just now, I am always struck by the impact JPEF's work has and how important it is for us to continue sharing the stories of Jewish partisans like Mira and her husband Nachum, fighter Paul Strassman, Aaron Bell and his brothers Tuvia, Asoil and Zeus, Jerry Kaidenow and his brother Howard, whose lessons inspire young people today to become upstanders. From them, they learned to speak out early and stand up against anti-Semitism and tyranny in all its forms. Today, this is as important as it has ever been. I would like to thank the members of the JPEF board and our staff for their tremendous work and dedication and our many generous supporters, without whom we would not be able to bring the inspiration of the Jewish Partisans to the world. As we close our commemoration tonight, we do so at a time when we find our world at war. Thousands of innocent Ukrainians have been killed while others perish defending their country's freedom from tyranny. In recent weeks, Israel has been besieged by terror attacks claiming more innocent lives. We offer up a prayer for peace. Shalom Rav, composed by cantor Meyer Finkelstein and sung by Amy Lieberman, granddaughter of Jewish partisans Rose and Joe Olivashalom Holm. And close with prayer for our beloved homeland, Hatikvah.
Oh. That was an amazing and incredibly touching program. I'm here right now with Irv Shelub, Mira's son, and he's in Israel right now. And we wanted to have a little conversation about Mira and try to answer some questions that he and I both have unique perspectives on. Firstly, Irv, I have to ask you the first question. What do you think of the program? What do you think of our tribute to your mom?
Mitch, it's good to be with you from Jerusalem. Truly remarkable, and I'm so grateful, and I'm inspired all over again.
Oh, thank you so much. Your family means so much to all of the JPEF family, and on behalf of the JPEF board and staff, I want to thank you and your family for being so instrumental in our work, and your mom, you know, inspiring me. I can't believe it was 2002 when I met her for the first time, 20 years ago. A lot has changed. A lot has changed in that time. Before we get into asking some questions, as we have some people submit questions, I wanted just to do a shout out again. I want to thank Elliot Fellison for doing such a great job of emceeing today's program. And I also wanted to thank Sherry Rosenblum, who's been behind the scenes making this all happen, and the rest of the JPEF board and staff. Thank you, everyone, for doing such a great job. Irv, we have some questions that people have submitted for us. And I think you are the best person on behalf of Mira and your family to answer. So let's go. I have this down, written down. Alice Cartwright in Toronto, Canada asked, was Mira afraid when she was fighting as a partisan? And what were her biggest fears and how did she overcome them?
So Mira had some fears, but Mira is a remarkable woman, as you all witnessed. And she overcame any fears at any time with her sense of optimism that things would work out and be better, and her remarkable will, what I will call an indomitable will. And that came from, I don't know exactly what, but almost certainly her rearing in her family, because other members, her sister, her brother, also had that same will, not just to survive, but to be productive and thrive just as she did.
And how do you think she overcame everything? Just how her internal wiring, was that it, do you think?
The internal wiring was crucial, particularly when you contrast it to my father. My mother always has had, throughout her life, an optimistic approach, a positive approach, an approach which said, not only yes, I can, but yes, I will. This was in contradistinction to my father, who sort of had a pessimistic approach and seemed to see the dark side. But she supported him as she supported everybody around her. So it was her own personal qualities, her own character, which generated such energy and such force of will, which in fact defines courage.
Now I have a question. Did that transfer to you or your other family members? That same.
I hope it did. I hope it did. I think it did. I think it all gave us the sense of industry and ambition, and that no matter what we faced in the way of adversity, a better day was ahead. That right. We could overcome obstacles, that we would have overcome obstacles. And frankly, for all three of us, and also for her grandchildren, that's the way it's been. Right. She's been inspiring and encouraging, and that attitude has been transferred, or I should say, has been inherited in her descendants.
Right. Well, that's great. That's great. Thank you for sharing that. Another question we have that relates to women partisans, and I'll answer, but you can feel free to chime in if you have any insights on it.
Sure.
This is by Taya Pearl in St. Louis, Missouri. Mira was a woman fighting with a partisan group. How groundbreaking was it to have Jewish women fighting back against the Nazis and others during this time, and why? Well, I'll tell you from my perspective, as you know, Rev, I interviewed about 50 surviving partisans, and I know from the research I have done, but less than 10% of partisan groups had women. So women were definitely a minority in it. And I think that it was very groundbreaking because women did not have those kind of fighting roles then. There was a tremendous amount of sexism, and there's a tremendous amount, I don't recall it happening with your mom, but with other Jewish women partisans who fought, they had difficulty entering groups because people weren't taking them seriously. And in fact, it was the Jewish groups that, of course, were not just fighting back against the Germans and the collaborators, but the Jewish groups were trying to save Jewish lives and trying to bring as many people together as, you know, people were in family camps or they were in fighting groups. And women had a much better chance in Jewish partisan groups, like the group that your mom was in, to actually be fighters.
I think my mom's group was a little bit exceptional. The group was called Orta Nikitsa. It was the fighting group for the Bielskis that had been made famous in the movie Defiance. But by and large, the women did not participate in actual action. There was an exception. It turned out to be Mira's sister, Sarah, who was very well known for blowing up trains.
Really?
And she absolutely insisted on participating, which shows you a little bit more of the will of those in her family, including my mother.
Yes, so,
So my mother was my father's companion. They did everything together. And that was pretty much the way it was for that small group called the Ordzi Nikitsa, the fighting wing, so to speak, of the Bielski group.
Right. There's another question that I'm going to answer. This was by Keenan Fine in Chicago. This question is, what are some of the most important lessons that young people can learn from the Jewish partisans, and how are they relevant to the challenges facing our world? So this is a complicated question, especially in terms of what's happening in the world today. But I think in terms of when we teach, and you know, when I interviewed your mother 20 years ago and we talked to the other partisans, we would ask the history, but we'd also ask the life lessons. What should the next generation learn? What should we teach them? And for the most part, they would say this. They would say, well, that young people can make a difference. And I think, you know, and that we must stand up to tyranny, oppression, anti-Semitism early. And I think that the idea that young people can make a difference and we must stand up is very important. I think that when we've talked to young people in classrooms which we would visit with your mom, and she would talk about that, you know, we all know the idea of being upstanders. When we see something happening that's wrong, we must stand up and do something. I think that when we think about what's happening today, specifically in Ukraine, I think in terms of, you know, the lessons, we're seeing average people, just like your mother, right? And just like your, you know, grandparents, these are average people who, you know, who weren't fighters, they weren't in the military, but they wanted to protect their country, they wanted to fight back, they wanted to live, they wanted to survive. And so it was average people standing up and making a difference, and also young people standing up and making a difference. Your mother, how old was your mom during this again? She was, what, 16 years old or something like that? Is that right?
When she went to the woods in 1942, she was then 20 years old, just barely.
She was 20 years old then, okay.
When so, she went into the woods, when the war started, right. She was, of course, much younger.
Right, exactly. And the war, so I think that was also something because, you know, many of the partisans were teenagers. And I think the fact that what we can learn is that young people can make a difference. You don't need to be an adult to make a difference. You don't have to be, you can be a young person and really change the world because you could stand up and really let people know what you believe in. And if you see something that is unjust, you stand up. And, you know, we use the word at JPEF, upstander. We don't want you to be a bystander. We want you to be an upstander. And I think these are really some of the important lessons that the partisans have taught us. And we really try to teach students who are learning about the work. I have one more question for you, Irv.
Before you go to the next question, let me just add a little bit to what you said, Mitch.
Please.
You know, I think one of the lessons is also when you know something is right and you commit yourself to doing what is right, be relentless. And in the case of the partisans, you may even have to engender the spirit of defiance. And I use that word because, of course, that was the word that was used to entitle the book and the movie. But the point is, act. And what it took from the partisans is courage. But what we learned from the partisans, because each partisan was a little bit different, is that different people can still engender the courage to act, to do right. something, to stand up for what is right, particularly when you know how wrong the opposition is.
Exactly. And I think that we can all make a difference. People say, what can I do? Absolutely. I'm just one person.
Absolutely.
You know, look what everyone does combined. It's really incredible. But no, thank you for that insight, that perspective. So we have one more question for us. I'm giving this to you.
Thanks,
Mitch. Are you ready?
I hope so.
So what was the spiritual battle that Mira refers to fighting in her interview on the JPEF website? Did she win this battle? And has she been spiritual throughout her life?
Spiritual, not in a mystical sense, but almost in a practical sense. And she's been winning the battle throughout her life. But spiritual in the sense of engendering the spirit of what we talked about before. I know what's right. I will be relentless. Yes, I can. And yes, I will. That indomitable will, which is the spirit of humanity at its best, particularly when it faces insurmountable odds or what seem to be insurmountable odds, that is what she meant by a spiritual battle, that you do have the spirit, everybody in their own individual way, but you can engender that force of will, which is courage. And that's all about the spirit of humanity and the spirit of what is good and what is right. And she really believed it and she really lived it.
Well, your mother is such a remarkable woman. I mean, all the times when she was, you know, at the San Francisco Yom HaShoah program and her singing the Partisan song. In fact, when I did the interview with her, she sang the Partisan song. And, you know, she's always had such a great, you know.
And that is a perfect example of the spirit. The hymn of that song, and that song was, in Yiddish, it was Zognit, don't say that this is the last road. And that was her spirit, and that's what she conveyed, and that's what the hymn of the partisans was. Never that's say awesome. This is the last road. The name of her book, from the Hirschglick poem, which was Zognit, as the Gäste lässt der Weg. Never say this is the last road. That's the spirit. And that's the spirit throughout her life. And that's the spirit of the Partisans. And that's the spirit that hopefully we can all embody.
No, and we all really should. And I wanted to thank you again for your time and speaking to us from Israel tonight. And I just also just want to, you know, thank again you and your family. And you've always been generous to me personally and all of JPEF. And, you know, and it's, I just want to say thank you. And it's a great honor to be able to chat with you tonight and kind of honor your mom and talk about her. And thank you for
Mitch, before I let you go and before you let me go, I want to return the commendation. I want to thank you personally and all of those involved in the Jewish Partisan Education Foundation for all that you've done to bring to light the wonder and the greatness of those people that resisted against terrible odds and in what seemed to be the most trying of times. You've brought it forth, and we are eternally, and I use that word advisedly, grateful. Thank you, Mitch. Thank you all at JPEF.
You're the best. Thank you, Irv. I hope to see you in San Francisco soon.
Yeah. Goodbye from Jerusalem.
Goodbye from San Francisco. Thank you, everyone. Have a good night.
Good night.